21 essence for the 21st century, God. Godless ethics. Of course, the cosmic mystery doesn't help us at all in maintaining the social world. People often argue that we must believe in God that gave some very concrete law to human, or else mortality will disappear and society will collapse into primordial chaos. It's certainly true that believing in God is vital to various social order, that it sometimes had positive consequences. Indeed, the very same religion that inspire hate and bigotry in some people inspire love and compassion in others. For example, in the early 1960s, Methodist minister Ted McNamara became aware of the plight of LGBT people in his community. He began exploring the situation of gays and lesbians in society in general, and in May 1964, Corbyn, the pioneering three-day dialogue between clergymen and gay and lesbian activities at the White Memorial Recreation Center in California. The participants subsequently set up the Council on Religion and the Homosexual, which in addition to the activities included Methodist, Episcopal, Lutheran, and United Church of Christ ministers. This was the first American organization to dare to use the word homosexual in its official title. In the following year, CRH activities ranged from organizing costume parties to taking legal action against unjust discrimination and persecution. The CRH became the seed of the gay rights movement in California. Reverend McNamara and other men of God who joined him were well aware of the biblical injunction against homosexuality, but they thought that it was more important to be true to the compassionate spirit of Christ than to the strict word of the Bible. Yet, though God can inspire us to act compassionately, religious faith is not a necessary condition for moral behavior. The idea that we need a supernatural being to make us act morally assumes that there is something unnatural about morality. But why? Morality of some kind of is natural. All social mammals, from chimpanzee to rat, have ethical code that limit behavior that like step and murder. Among humans, morality is present in all society, even though not all of them believe in the same God or in any God. Christians act with charity even without believing in the Hindu pastoring. Muslims value honesty despite rejecting the divinity of Christ. And secular countries such as Denmark and the Czech Republic aren't more violent than devout countries such as Iran and Pakistan. Morality doesn't mean following divine command. It means reducing suffering. Therefore, in order to act morality, you don't need to believe in any myth or story. You just need to develop a deep appreciation of suffering. If you really understand how an action causes unnecessary suffering to yourself or to others, you will naturally abstain from it. People nevertheless murder, rape, and steal because they have only a superficial appreciation of the misery disclosed. They are fixated on satisfying their immediate lust or greed without concern for the impact on others or even for the long-term impact of themselves. Even inquisitors who deliberately inflict as much pain as possible on their victim usually use various desensitizing and dehumanizing techniques in order to distance themselves from what they are doing. You might object that every human naturally seeks to avoid feeling miserable, but why would a human care about the misery of others unless some god demand it? One obvious answer is that humans are social animals, and therefore their happiness depends on to a very large extent on their relation with others. Without love, friendship, and community, who could be happy? If you live a lonely, self-centered life, you almost guarantee to be miserable. So, at the very least, to be happy, you need to care about your family, your friends, and your community members. What then? About complete strangers? Why not murder stronger stranger and take their possession to enrich myself and my tribe? Many thinkers have constructed elaborate social theory explaining why in the long run such behavior is counterproductive. You would not like to live in a society where strangers are routinely robbed and murdered. Not only would you be in constant danger, but you would lack the benefit of the things like commerce, which depends on trust between strangers. Mechants don't usually visit dens of thieves. That's how secular theoreticians from ancient China to modern Europe have justified the golden rule of don't do to others what you would not like them to do to you. Don't do to others what you would not like them to do to you. Yet, you do not really need such complex long-term theory to find a natural base for universal compassion. Forget about commerce for a moment. On a much more immediate level, hurting others always hurts me too. Every violent act in the world begins with a violent desire in somebody's mind, which disturbs that person's own peace and happiness before it disturbs the peace and happiness of anyone else. Thus, people seldom steal unless they first develop a lot of greed and envy in their mind. People don't usually murder unless they fight to generate anger and hatred. Emotions such as greed, envy, anger, and hatred are very unpleasant. You cannot experience joy and harmony when you are boiling with anger and envy. Long before you murder anyone, your anger has already killed your own peace of mind. Indeed, you might keep boiling with anger for years without ever actually murdering the object of your hatred. In each case, you haven't hurt anyone else, but you have nonetheless hurt yourself. It is therefore your natural self-interest and not the command of some god that should induce you to do something about your anger. If you are completely free of anger, you would feel far better than if you murdered an obnoxious enemy. For some people, a strong belief in the compassionate God that commands us to turn the other cheek may help in curbing anger. That's been the enormous contribution of religious belief to the peace and harmony of the world. Unfortunately, for other people, religious belief actually stroke and justifies their anger, especially if someone dares to insult their God and ignores his wishes. So, the value of the lawgiver, God, ultimately depends on the behavior of his devotee. If they act well, they can believe anything they like. Similarly, the value of religious rite and sacred place depends on the type of feeling and behavior they inspire. If visiting a temple makes people experience peace and harmony, that's wonderful. But if a particular temple causes violence and conflict, what do we need it for? It's clearly a dysfunctional temple, just as it's pointless to fight over a thick tree that produces thorn rather than fruit. It's also pointless to fight over a defective temple that produces enmity rather than harmony. Not visiting any temple and not believing in any god is also a viable option. As the last few centuries have proved, you don't need to invoke God's name in order to live moral life. Secularism can provide us with all the values we need. We don't need to invoke God's name in order to live a moral life. Secularism can provide us with all the values we need.